video, we'll create an API that runs Bash. Specifically, we'll templatize Bash scripts and then use values from the API request body to fill out the Bash script and run it. This pattern shines in flexibility since there are so many CLIs that we can use in our Bash scripts. This entire system will be no code and very quick to set up. That said, we'll share all the configurations in the description of this video. Let's quickly create a diagram for what we're trying to achieve here, and then we'll jump into the Google Cloud Console and an IDE to set up these resources. So users will make API calls to a service running on Google Cloud's Cloud Run. If you're using a different cloud or a different container platform, you should still be able to follow along. When we get those API requests from users, they'll be translated to Bash commands. We are going to publicly expose this service on the internet, but we'll protect it with bearer token authentication. Again, if this doesn't match your use case because you're deploying an internal API, you should still be able to follow along. We are going to use Artifact Registry on Google Cloud to store the Docker images for this system. We'll use the Cloud Shell and Cloud Shell IDE to create and build our Docker image. This is going to be a pretty lean service setup. We'll only need a dozen or so lines of YAML configuration, and then we, of course, need our Bash script. With the open source Webhooks project, the hard work of translating HTTP calls to Bash commands and then running the commands will be done for us. This is a pretty mature and robust open source project with a lot of configurability to match your specific needs. The flow of Docker assets will essentially be this here. We'll be building in our IDE, pushing to Artifact Registry, and then pulling from our Cloud Run service. With what we're trying to achieve now established, let's jump into the Cloud Shell IDE and start to set up some of these resources. Specifically, we'll be creating a Dockerfile and a couple of configuration files. We want the editor and not just the terminal, so we can more easily view and edit configuration files. Top priority first. Let's get this color theme changed to dark. Then we'll open up a terminal here. Great. So next, we'll create a folder here and get started on our Docker file. In this Docker file, the first thing we need to do is specify the base image to be from the webhook project. We can see this base image if we open up the GitHub page and scroll down in the README. As you can see here, we're using this Docker image. This GitHub repository is where you'll find all the documentation and example configurations for this project. So at this point, we now need to install additional libraries for use in our Bash scripts. We'll keep our demonstrated example pretty simple and not install anything. In your use case though, you might want to add something like an apk install command. That would look something like this. Next, we need to set up our configuration files, a hooks.yaml file and a pass.sh file. This is going to be our YAML configuration for the service, and then we have our Bash script that we're going to run when we get HTTP requests. Finally, we're just exposing a port to run the service on, and then specifying how to run the service, including the use of the verbose flag. The verbose flag increases logging so that we can better debug our service during the initial implementation testing and validation. We'll demonstrate how this is useful later on. Okay, so for the configuration files, let's start with the hooks.yaml file. We're providing a few things in this configuration. First, we have an ID for the first configuration, and this implies the URL path that the webhook will be reachable on. Specifically, we'll need to hit /hooks/example to hit this particular configuration. As you're probably correctly inferring, we can have many different webhooks and webhook configurations running on the same service. We're further specifying that our pass.sh should be executed when folks hit this API, and then we're providing a working directory. As a next step here, we're going to hard code a bearer token to enforce authentication. We'll specify that as a match role, and for the value to match, let's use a base64 encoding of a random string. This is a quick and easy way to demonstrate basic authorization, but production use cases will usually need some tweaking of this approach. Just take a peek at the documentation or implement authorization on the network layer, like at a load balancer or API gateway level. Next up, we have a location that we're passing in as an argument to our bash script. We're going to get that location value from the payload source, which means we're going to read the JSON body of the request to get the value. All right, next up, we have our pass bash file. This is what's actually going to run when we hit the API. In this demonstration, we're just doing a hello world. However, feel free to have complex, multi-line bash scripts and any sort of CLIs in your own implementation. This argument here is being provided by that location value that we talked about earlier. So we don't have to hard code everything in our bash scripts. We can use arguments that are provided by the HTTP requests themselves. While I've been saying that we're running a bash script here, I'm abusing terminology a bit. This is technically a pure shell script, but bash and other shells can be used in the exact same way. Just remember, if the base Docker image doesn't include a desired shell or CLI, then you'll need to install it yourself in the Dockerfile. Also, a quick note on security here. This architectural pattern is very prone to injection attacks. For example, imagine somebody passed this argument through their HTTP request. I don't actually know for sure if this would terminate the echo command. But that's the idea with injection attacks, and you need to be very careful with that. If your service is only being called in predictable ways by other services you control over internal networking, you're probably okay. However, if you're exposing an API publicly, you'll need to implement at least authentication, input validation, and input sanitization. Cloud run services are somewhat isolated from propagation or escalation attacks, but even if only the API itself is compromised, that's one component too many. In any case, with that disclaimer out of the way and all our files are ready to go, let's go ahead and get our service ready for deployment. First, let's set up an artifact registry repository for our Docker image. We'll create that in the Cloud Console. So let's type in artifact registry here and enable any required APIs. Okay, so we now need to create a repository. Let's choose Docker for the type and call it bash webhook. For the region, let's select a multi-region US configuration. If we click into the newly created repository, we'll get a nice configuration command that we can run in our IDE. We can then start pushing to the repository. So let's go ahead and copy this path here. Note that our project is called bash webhook and our repository is called bash webhook. So this looks duplicative, but that's just because of the naming we've used. Anyway, let's take our path here and run a Docker build command. In the repository, we'll give this image the name service and the tag latest. Once the image has been built, we can push it to our newly created artifact registry repository. Once I refresh over here, we'll see our new service image. Now, onto Cloud Run, let's create a service that uses this image. We'll call this Bash Webhook, and we'll allow unauthenticated invocations. Again, we have that bearer token control, so while the service is public, it will not be generally accessible. The remaining fields can use defaults. So let's create the service. We're getting an error here, which highlights a place where folks commonly get stuck with Cloud Run. It's worth walking through this together. So Cloud Run expects us to have a port environment variable, or to at least serve traffic on port 8080 by default. Let's correct the error by editing this service and setting the container port to 9000. That will now match with what we've exposed in the Dockerfile. So now we have our service running, and this is the corrected revision, which is running on port 9000. Let's test our service with the URL here. We'll create some space in the terminal for this and then run. A curl command to the root gives us a successful health check. So we can next hit our example webhook configuration. We get a rejection and notice that our hook rules weren't satisfied. That's as expected, and we haven't added the bearer token yet. Let's do that now. We're also going to explicitly specify that we're passing a JSON file, and then we'll also provide our HTTP request body. We now get the 200, and we don't get that hook rules error. Let's go back to our revision and check the logs to see the successful invocation. If we scroll down to the bottom here, we should see that this was triggered successfully. Instead, it looks like we have one more error to resolve. Specifically, we need to enable the execute bit on the pass script permissions. This is also a good error to work through together. So let's update the script permissions, rerun our build, push the image, and redeploy the service. Looks good. The error resolution cycle nicely showcases the value of Cloud Run logs, as well as the service's verbose flag. So, with that new revision deployed, let's go ahead and rerun our curl command. Again, this looks successful. So we're passing all those hook rules. If we go into the logs, we can see here that our hello world worked correctly. We had our echo command and we resolved the argument with the world value that was passed in our HTTP request. This Cloud Run service is a pretty easy and cheap way to run Dockerized services like this, but other platforms like Kubernetes could also be used. We hope that you have some fun playing with this architecture and that this demonstration was helpful. If you have any questions about this setup, please provide them in the comments of this video. Thank you for watching. Thank you.